A very good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item of business is to consider the responses we've received relating to our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's budget for 2023-24, and I refer members to paper number one. And we've had replies from the Scottish Government, Police Scotland and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So I'm just going to open it up to members to come in with any issues or points that they would like to raise. I'm quite happy for you to come in on any of the pieces of correspondence. I'm not necessarily going to take them in any particular order. Russell?
Yep. Thank you. So, first of all, the response from the Justice Secretary, I think it's just worth noting that it talks of cuts to the Scottish Government capital budget, but it's worth putting on the record that it's the highest block grant on record, and any cuts relate, I believe, to the extraordinary spending due to COVID. So there are no cuts in that meaningful sense. In respect of the response from Police Scotland, we asked about the potential blue light collaboration across Scotland, and the answer, I don't really think, tells us anything. Lots of words, but no actual tangible detail about what is actually happening and what this £5 million might be spent on. Turning to body-worn cameras, which we as a committee have raised on a number of occasions, it remains the case that Police Scotland uniquely is the only force in the UK without them. And if I'm interpreting this letter correctly, it looks like it won't be until 2027 that all officers will have them, which I think is extraordinary. And indeed, I don't think it's even guaranteed. It puts a price tag on this of £21.5 million, which is obviously a lot of money, but in the grand scheme of things, is not. And I think it requires further explanation from the SPA and Police Scotland as to why this has not been prioritised long before now, given the relatively small sum of money that it would cost. Because, of course, it protects police officers and it protects the public. And I think that's probably all as things stand. Thank you
very much. Anybody else? Pauline and then Jamie. Pauline?
Thank you, convener. It's really just a re-emphasis of the points Russell Findlay's made about for the blue light collaboration. It's just not clear what that means and if it really is practical. But my major concern is the rollout of body-worn cameras. I mean, it's quite clear. I talked to the Scottish Police Federation. I mean, there is a need for it in the Scottish Police Force. And the length of time it's going to take to roll it out is concerning. It also concerned me that it's going to be done division by division. So that would tend to indicate that if you're in one division, you benefit from the rollout, but you might, if you're at the end of the programme in another division, I mean, perhaps there isn't another way of doing this, but I just think it speaks to the concerns I have for the police budget overall. When you see police numbers, although not as bad as it could have been, falling to those levels. So I think it's a deep concern where we've ended up on the police budget overall.
Yeah, thank you very much. Jamie?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, colleagues. I mean, the first point on body-worn cameras is I read on page 5 of the Police Scotland, page 1 of their response, page 5 of our papers, that it says that the anticipated implementation will be spread across 3 financial years, taking us up to the year 26-27. I mean, realistically, that's 4 years away from now. And I do struggle in the current age of technology, whether looking ahead 3 or 4 years away to look at implementing body-worn cameras is realistic, if that's being done purely on the basis they haven't got the money, therefore have to spread it across 3 years, or it'll take that long to find a technical solution. I'm pretty sure there are providers out there who could implement a solution much more quickly. Perhaps that would be best achieved if Police Scotland collaborated with other forces who have already gone on to second or even third generation technology of this nature. There surely must be something out there in the market that would be able to roll it out more quickly. So I'm less focused on the cost and the numbers. We all know the arguments around that that my colleague presented, but more about the timescales. It's not just that, of course. Body-worn cameras then feed into a system of further ICT transformation, which then takes that information, those assets and that data, and feeds it very quickly into a system that can process it as evidence and turn around cases more quickly. That's the important bit. It's not just the cameras and the fact that they're there, of course, they do act as a visual deterrent. It's what you do with that information that's important. And that only that will deliver improvements. It's very unclear whether the cameras themselves will be accompanied by significant investment in what happens at the back end in terms of case management and evidence handling. So I'd like a little bit more information on that, perhaps from the SPA or Police Scotland at some point in the future. I won't comment on the blue light collaboration. The word collaboration is always a positive one, a welcome one, and we do see some very good practice of it. I saw it this morning on my way into the office with an ambulance driving out of a joint building with the fire service, and that's all very welcome. But when we move on to the next agenda item, we talk about police mental health. Is what we're really looking for in collaboration is what work has been done across emergency services with other public services to reduce the strain and the workload on frontline police officers, because ultimately that will help free up time and speed up processes. On budget, though, and it's budget's the important one, I did actually try to raise the issue of the Barnahus in some parliamentary questions recently. I think I may have actually made a call in a previous evidence session in committee for a bit more of a long-term plan on the rollout of them or some analysis on their success or otherwise. I think that's all very positive, and I look forward to the new Cabinet Secretary furnishing us with that. My big issue, though, really is on the budget itself, and I think we would be missing a trick if we didn't refer to the two responses from Police Scotland and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service on the budget itself. It is welcome that since our initial pre-budget scrutiny, that the government has been forthcoming with more cash. And I know, you know, times are tough and money is tight. However, we do have to acknowledge the response to that extra cash. I think my issue is the wording and the language being used, particularly in the response from Police Scotland, who on page 7 say that they estimate that the current £53 million of capital funding that they will have this financial year is not sufficient to meet our basic needs of our asset rolling replacement programme. They then go on to talk about slippage management, and effectively it seems that they're drawing down on future budgets in current year financial years. And the effect of that is quite stark. They're quite explicit with us that they need £85 million this financial year to be sustainable, I think, yeah, is the language they use. That's somewhere in the middle of their average between £80 and £100 million that they need per year to be sustainable. To manage that shortfall of £32 million, they are, you know, playing with the numbers, if you like, as best they can, but all that does is take money out of future year's capital budget and just compounds the problem. And the problem with that is, if you look at what happened to Scottish Fire and Rescue Service's historic capital underfunding, is you end up down the line with hundreds of millions of pounds of capital underfunding that's been compounded year upon year upon year, which no government will ever have the money to backfill. So the problem is it starts small and it grows, and that's my concern about that. I'm also slightly concerned that it seems the message that they're giving off seems to say that they will just do the bare basics. And the bare basics include, for example, a reduced workforce with an operating model of 16,500 officers. It seems to be now just accepted that we will be working with a reduced workforce as a result of the resource and capital budget issues. So I'm concerned that there's still a massive shortfall. It's still way below what they're asking of government. They've been quite explicit what they need, not what they want, what they need to be sustainable, to supply the bare minimum. And, of course, they haven't got that. On the resource budget, that's another point of concern. This is a point I think many of us raised when we did pre-budget scrutiny, is that any additional money that would be allocated for resource, and there's £80 million additional being announced, that's very welcome. But all the way through it, as I recall, a warning that that will just be simply swallowed up by inflationary pay increases. So it's not actually additional resource budget. And they've confirmed that by saying that 37 million of the 80 will be simply meeting a 5% pay award. Now, thankfully, that's been accepted in the fire service. It hasn't. They're looking at 7 or even perhaps more percent. So there is an issue there that all that additional cash has simply been disappeared into the ether with pay increases. And we know the percentage point cost of every pay increase. So it's not, you know, I think that itself raises issues. And that's something that we flagged with them. On capital funding for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, I am concerned about this because the capital funding of £32.5 million that's been announced is, in quoting the words of the fire service itself, not sufficient to meet all the service's needs. We know, and we've well rehearsed some of the issues around access to facilities for firefighters, basic PPE, decontamination, and proper dignified spaces. It should be, in 100% of fire stations, and far too many are in poor condition. This clearly is not going to chip the surface of any of that. And I think that'll be a source of disappointment to firefighters. So I think overall, we asked for more money. There was a bit more money. That was welcome. But much of it will be swallowed up by pay increases on the resource side. Much of it will be swallowed up by inflationary pressures on the capital side. And across the board, it's far below what's needed for standing still, not just improvements in investment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Jamie. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. I don't disagree with a lot of what's been said from various people so far on the budget stuff. I'm a bit confused. I mean, the budget's settled now for this year. And are they making, I'm not disputing what's been said, but is this sort of a preemptive strike for the next round of negotiations? Because we are where we are with it. So we're a bit confused with some of the stuff that they're saying there. My big concern is the body-worn cameras. And again, looking at the response that was sent in from Police Scotland, I mean, I admit I'm not good with graphs and things like that, but I found it quite confusing. And as Jamie was saying, you know, it would be good to know exactly what, you know, is it budget or is it operational? Why is it being presented in this way? We were talking about this 5 or 6 years ago. And I understood then it was close to happening and it's still not happened. I was just wondering, would it be possible somewhere to slot in maybe a wee evidence session with somebody who knows about this, you know, whether it's the SPA or whoever the person that's leading it would be, just so that we could, it'd be better rather than letters going back and forward, I think, if we could actually just sit and talk to them and ask questions. That I would prefer that anyway.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else want to come in? Russell, you're coming back in, and then I'll maybe just kind of wind things up.
To pick up on something Rona said about body-worn cameras, I happened to be at a retail security industry conference recently speaking to an individual who supplies body cameras to police forces elsewhere, and he was expressing some surprise and frustration about his dealings over the years with Police Scotland. Numerous attempts to, or suggestions that they were going to go ahead, and it didn't come to pass, and they couldn't figure out why. So someone like that might give us a bit of a different perspective as well.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Okay, thank you. So just to maybe kind of pull your comments together, I probably agree with everything that has been said. Very, very challenging financial climate for Police Scotland and Scottish Fire and Rescue. It's been very helpful to hear your comments, in particular around the information we've received about body-worn cameras, and I'll come back to that. Just a couple of points from myself. I noted with interest the discussion that took place on the 23rd of March at the Scottish Police Authority at their meeting where they discussed the budget. I have to say, very comprehensive discussion, a lot of probing questions for the Chief Constable, and a helpful overview of the approach that Police Scotland will take in extremely challenging circumstances, and certainly acknowledging hard choices and the prioritisation of resources will be required. Obviously, there is the issue of the pressure of pay awards, and you're right, Jamie, to point out the additional funding that was provided by the Scottish Government. Around about 50% of that has gone to pay awards. So the budget was approved. The Police Scotland did present a balanced budget, which was approved by the Resources Committee at that meeting. And I was interested to note a comment by the Chief Constable that in to a certain extent, the difficulties and the challenges that the budget presented this year led to the budget almost never having been so informed. So not at all saying that it's a bed of roses, but nonetheless, there's obviously been a lot of work undertaken. In terms of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, as members have pointed out, very challenging circumstances that they're facing across property, assets, vehicles, pay awards. So very difficult environment. And I did take a wee bit of time to have a look at the Audit Commission report that they referenced in their response, and the challenge of the legacy of the financial circumstances that the individual fire services faced at the time of the services being amalgamated. So, if anything, I would be keen to observe and monitor developments around the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service budget going forward. So, as I think, as Rona said, the budget process is now complete. I'm sure that organisations are now thinking about next year's budget. I'm pleased that we've had some very helpful contributions on the budget issue, and very happy to keep budgetary issues under review going forward. Finally, coming back to body-worn cameras, I'm always trying to balance progressing work and not getting into ping-pong correspondence. But nonetheless, I think in terms of this particular issue, it may be that we can do some follow-up work just to get a little bit more clarity around timescales, what's the sort of context to where we are with timescales and funding. So happy to take that away and correspond with members on how we can take that work forward, given that we've got quite a busy work programme coming down the track. Jamie, do you want to come back in?
Not on that issue, but yes, I think that's a very good suggestion from Rona. Be good to challenge that and keep the pressure on. However, I did wonder if there would be... I don't know when we're next due to hear from the SPA in front of us, probably not for some time. And as you know, obviously we're already in that financial budget year, and already we'll be looking ahead to the next one. But I'm not a forensic accountant, and I wonder, either from them or perhaps the Spice or others, is just someone to help us understand this over allocation that they talk about, because it's quite significant. And again, I'm not an accountant, but effectively they're saying that they will spend more than they have this year by about 30 odd million. But it's a bit unclear as to how that all pans out in the books. And again, I just want to, you know, what we don't want to be doing is starting pre-budget scrutiny for next financial year straight off the bat with the 30-odd million quid off the bottom line that's has to come out to fund this year's investment. So there's very few public agencies can overspend in this way They've obviously found a very clever way of accounting for it, but I'd like to understand it a little bit more.
Okay, thank you, Jamie. You want to come back in, Russell?
Just very quickly, it's in relation to the £5 million allocation for collaboration. The Police Scotland response, which is on page 5, says absolutely nothing. It just doesn't answer the question. We know they might not be able to specify exactly what they're going to be doing, but surely they can give us some idea of what this looks like, what they're hoping to achieve, what engagement they've had with the other services and so on. But the answer is really just meaningless. So, and that's not a budgetary, it's not revisiting the budget, it's just answering the question as to what's going on with this money.
Yeah, I would agree. I think the information that we have in relation to the Blue Light collaboration is fairly light. I think that's possibly because they're at a fairly early stage with it, and there is still work underway to really focus in on what exactly, which projects and what work the collaboration will support. And I'll maybe come on to that in the next agenda item, but your comments are noted. In relation to your point, Jamie, I agree, probably SPICE is our first port of call in terms of maybe getting some more clarity on the accounting side of the police budget in terms of, I think, the slippage that you've referenced. So happy to take that away. Okay, if there's no more points, then thanks very much for that. And we'll move on to our next agenda item, which is consideration of the correspondence that we've received relating to policing and mental health. And I refer members to paper number 2. Just before I open it up to members, I want to thank the Scottish Police Authority and all the attendees at last week's conference on workforce trauma. It was a very worthwhile event that included contributions from a range of stakeholders and some very powerful lived experience contributions as well. It was reassuring to hear about the level of commitment to make positive and lasting change for officers and staff. We heard what's already in place and also a bit about the work that is underway to effect the change needed. I think there was quite a lot of honesty in the room, particularly around the role of supervisors and leaders. So I think it did lead to a constructive session last week. So in terms of today, we've got correspondence from Police Scotland, the SPA and HMICS, and you'll find a summary of each of the responses at the beginning of paper 2. So again, I'm just going to open it up to members to come in with any points that they would like to make. Russell?
Yep, thank you very much, Convener. I think in the main, the responses we've seen today are slightly disappointing and suggest a reluctance to be open and honest about the tragic suicide of police officers, which I've raised these issues repeatedly in the Chamber, in the Committee and in writing. And every time I do so, more people come forward with shocking and frankly heartbreaking accounts. Now, one of these is a former detective officer of high rank with more than 20 years' service, and I want to call him P for the purpose of this account, and I thank you, Convener, for allowing me a bit of time to explain this particular case. Now, this officer was working on a murder investigation in which a colleague was implicated of criminality. He was immediately suspended from duty. P was suspended from duty, and he says, quoting, "Two professional standards officers informed me I was suspended without any explanation of the allegations against me. I had my warrant card taken from me and was told, you better get yourself a trade, you're going to need it. This was a threat of sacking before any investigation had been carried out. I was sent home and had barely any contact from the police for nearly a year." He describes this as a bewildering experience, as he had no involvement whatsoever in the alleged crime. He twice went on to attempt to take his own life. He eventually saw a psychiatric nurse who told him he needed to see a clinical psychologist. He asked the police for assistance with this, but was told that they could not help, they did not offer that service, and that he should, quote, keep my chin up. Now, he became isolated at work and was given menial jobs, which he says destroyed his self-esteem and resulted in a mental breakdown and further suicidal thoughts. He and other officers who were subject of investigation were lumped together in one place to undertake what he saw and they saw as meaningless chores, paperwork and so on. He became friendly with a young officer in his 20s, who I'll refer to as L. L was accused of an assault, despite CCTV apparently showing him to be innocent. 2 years later, L was still under investigation, and P says, quoting, L confided in me that he could not bear the pressure and felt absolutely hopeless. I knew he had very recently emailed professional standards explaining this to them, demanding answers. L received a bland response telling him the investigation was ongoing. A week after this email, L took his own life, and the location was significant to policing, but I will not state that publicly. And within hours of L's death, Officer P entered his workplace, and he said, and I'd like to quote this, I was immediately summoned by a senior officer and told without hesitation, mere hours after L's death, that this was absolutely nothing to do with him being under investigation and Police Scotland were not responsible in any way. I was utterly dumbstruck and disgusted at this utterly ignorant explanation in the immediate aftermath of the death of my friend, end quote. Now, P spent 5 years under investigation until he was dismissed without notice last year. He describes the process as a kangaroo court operating on the balance of probability. He said it was a one-sided investigation from the start and he never had hope of being vindicated. It's worth noting that no criminal proceedings were taken against him, and he says, I'm still dogged by these feelings and suicidal thoughts to this day. It seems that protecting Police Scotland's reputation is the only thing that matters. There was zero sincerity or compassion for what had happened. Just protect the organisation's reputation at all costs, and that is the root cause of all these issues. Now, P knows of other cases which resulted in officers taking or attempting to take their own lives. I've heard of many other similar accounts, and I dare say after this, I'll probably hear of more. And despite repeatedly raising concerns about the damage done by the complaints process, I think there are four key points. There's a failure to record the number of officer suicides or whether these officers were subject to internal investigation. The routine decision by the Crown Office not to hold fatal accident inquiries in any of these cases that we know about, unlike in England and Wales where an inquest would be conducted as a matter of routine. A lack of willing by all parties to explore cases where there's evidence that the complaint process may have been a factor, and the SPA's willingness, it appears, to accept Police Scotland's position, which can best be summarised as nothing to see here. Now, from P and from the many other officers and their families who I've been speaking to, there's a fundamental lack of faith in this process, and I know that they are willing, many of them are willing to speak out. They don't quite know how to do that, but they certainly don't intend to let this rest. But thank you for your time.
OK, thanks very much, Russell, for raising this case. I'm sorry to hear of this account. We can't, of course, go into investigating individual cases and issues. And I think I would speak on behalf of all members that we do take this really seriously, hence the work that we've been doing over the last few months. And thanks again for raising this issue. OK, Pauline, you've got your hand up.
Thanks. Thanks to Russell Findlay for bringing those cases to the attention of the committee. I just wanted to ask Russell, the accounts that you've given, would you agree that it seems to cross over into the area of the treatment of police officers and the disciplinary process? There seems to be more than one thing that you've outlined there, which would be cause of concern for me if it would take 2 years in an internal process for any allegation and you can understand how that is clearly going to affect the mental health of officers. But I just wondered if you thought there was another element to what you've outlined, which is the internal processes of disciplinary action against police officers should not take 2 years to come to.
I think for what it's worth, undoubtedly, police officers are, given what they often experience in the front line of their duties, are more susceptible and prone to some of these mental health issues. And we have been addressing separately what appears to be a lack of support generally, and it does appear that Police Scotland, the SPA and the Federation are all very much behind efforts to improve that, which is to be welcomed. But separately, there is this cohort of officers who have been subject to allegations of wrongdoing, sometimes minor, sometimes more serious, and the cases can be characterised by basically taking far too long, apparently being unjust on the basis that the conclusions reached before evidence is even looked at, and a sense of abandonment and hopelessness, which is feeding cases of officers either attempting to take their own lives or successfully completing suicide. And I think there's a reluctance on the part of the authorities to look at that element because, according to survivors and families, they suggest there's some culpability on the part of the authorities for what's occurred because they've not responded to concerns that these officers are in a bad way because of the process. So, yeah, thank you.
OK, anybody else like to come in? Jamie?
Jamie and Rona.
And Rona. Jamie?
Thank you, Convener. I won't take too long on this. And I should, you know, I really do commend the work of the committee on spending a lot of time on this, and we have. And it's interesting listening to the story from Russell. It reminded me of the session that we had as a committee with held in private and anonymously with people who had experienced similar. And I think everyone in the committee sat in various groups and listened to some of those stories. So I know that, you know, what's been said is we've heard already ourselves from others, and the similarities are striking. And I certainly was, you know, to this day I'm still, you know, still have strong thoughts about the individual that I met and this, you know, the sorry state of affairs that actually a couple of them, you know, grown men who are, you know, broken as a result of the system. And I think what's come through a lot of this is, and it's not been acknowledged, and, you know, there are lots of warm words, as I would expect to read in a response like this from Police Scotland. And I don't doubt for a second that there are some very senior staff within the organisation who do want to do something about this, who do take it seriously. I don't doubt that for a second. Nobody wishes ill on their employees. But there are a lot of buzzwords being used, and there's nothing that addresses some of the underlying factors and recurring themes that we're hearing as a committee that I would like them to address. And there are some very specific, clear issues. I said I wasn't going to be long, and here I go with lists. But the first one is an important one, and that's the churn of higher-ranking officers, which seems to lead to huge issues around change management within the organisation. And we heard direct experience of the effect that has on officers when someone new comes in with a new direction of travel, and it's my way or the highway, and the effect that has on junior-ranking members of staff who not just do not have the confidence to challenge it, but are within an organisation where it's, you know, actively frowned upon. It is a hierarchical organisation as such. The second was that of a lack of poor organised HR support and processes, and that's come out, I think, from some of the protocol failures that we've heard around disciplinary matters. The third was that around management of long-term sickness, and those officers who feel like they're just seen as being problematic, especially if it's not a physical injury. Those with physical injuries are dealt with perhaps more positively by their peers or by management, because you can see the injury and it's a sign of bravery perhaps in service. But being off for mental health reasons, which are injuries in their own right as a byproduct of the job, are seen somehow as weaknesses instead. And that is really having an effect on people. There's clearly an inadequacy of mental health support. I do notice that there is a re-tendering for the employee assistance programme, which will kick in next April, so it's about a year away. But again, it's just a phone number, you know, and it's someone in an outsourced call centre at the end of the line. I think they need to up their game on that. It really comes down to, though, is the points that I made in part one of the meeting today, and that's the reduced workload that they're having, the reduced officer level resource levels that they're working with, which clearly puts an added pressure. We know at the top end we're losing people with experience, so you have a lot of younger officers, and this is confirmed to me when I went to the SPF event across the road recently, where they do feel that they're getting chucked out on the front line to deal with very traumatic situations in a much more quickly. And of course, it's part of the job. Some of the horrendous things they'll have to deal with, but they're doing it in their first couple of weeks, you know, having been in training and suddenly, you know, dealing with suicides and other horrendous situations that they're turning up to. It's both the volume and the type of workload which has massively changed, as we know, and I don't think anything's been done to address that, which is back to our collaboration issue and actually removing some of those tasks away from frontline officers. You won't really solve the problem until they're able to just do what they're supposed to be doing. And the problem is, if they're spending their whole day every day dealing with quite severe mental health situations themselves, then they're clearly taking that home with them. So until we have a much more fundamental and honest conversation about the workload, the volume and the type of work that they've been asked to do, I don't really think you'll fix the problem. All we're doing is tinkering around the edges of how you support them when they do have a problem. It's always better to prevent than cure, convener. So I felt like, you know, welcome words, but not enough detail.
Okay, thank you very much. Rona and then Fulton.
Thanks, convener. It was just to ask on Russell's issue and, you know, the cases he was referring to. Have we had an exchange with the police specifically on suicide as a committee? I just want to put on record, I think the committee is doing really good work in the whole, but not on the wider issue of mental health, but specifically on suicide.
It's certainly an issue that Russell and others have raised in the past, but more from the perspective of the follow-up and what is in place in the aftermath of an officer or a member of staff taking their own life, but not specifically on probing the issue.
Some of the questions that Russell raised, I don't know the answer to, and I may have missed the correspondence or whatever, but, you know, I think it would be good just to, rather than, you know, obviously the wider mental health issue is incredibly important and we've been doing a lot of work in that, but to hone in specifically on the suicide issue, I think would be good, as a committee.
That's a good suggestion. I think our challenge might be looking at that and fitting that in, but I think given that we've taken a lot of time to explore this particular issue, I'm sure that we would that we can fit that in along the way in our work programme. Russell, do you want to come in?
Just very quickly, I can respond to that. The first time I raised it was when we had a police witness here to talk about policing mental health, and I asked how many officers had died from suicide. He said he didn't know, and he'd get back to us, and he didn't get back to us with those numbers. It then transpired that they're not recorded, and then the SPA and Police Scotland wrote to us, and the SPA's position was essentially they had been aware of the spate of suicides that had been in the public domain, had asked Police Scotland whether this had any bearing on their work issues, and they were told by Police Scotland they didn't, and I think that showed a distinct lack of curiosity. And subsequently we got a letter from the Crown Office which set out their reasoning behind not, in these cases, instructing fatal accident inquiries. They're judged on a case-by-case basis. There are obviously sensitivities about it. But in the cases where I know that the officers have felt they were under pressure and had made this clear to Police Scotland, surely there's a public interest in holding fatal accident inquiries. So.
Thanks, Russell. I think the only other thing I'd maybe add to that is the HMICS is obviously undertaking a review around policing. It's more around the response to people in communities who are distressed or unwell, as opposed to police trauma, if you like. But I think within that, there is an overlap.
I think that
in some ways, I know it's hard to separate, but it should be seen as a standalone issue, the suicide part of it, and because the wider mental health issues part is incredibly important, as I say, but I think that's very specific and it should be dealt with that way, I think.
Okay, yeah, and we can look at making that maybe a specific piece of work within this ongoing work around mental health and policing. Yeah, of course.
It might be one that someone can come back to me later with. Obviously, the process at the moment seems to be that the unfortunate suicide of a serving officer, particularly police, as opposed to other forms of emergency services, can only arise if the Crown decides to hold an FAI. I do wonder, is there another solution that may, you know, perhaps another legislative top-down solution that would mandate some other form of automatic inquiry into such a situation? And I don't know what the situation is in England, Wales. I know it's a different legislative landscape as well. However, I'm not saying for a second that we mandate the Lord Advocate to do X, Y, or Z, although that is always a solution. Laws can do that. But I wonder if there's some other form of investigation that could take place, that has to take place, irrespective, that then could be followed by a proper full-on FAI if the Crown so decides. But in the meantime, it seems to be all or nothing. And in far too many cases, it's the nothing that happens.
I think a couple of things there. You may recall the correspondence that we received from the Lord Advocate back in January, and she sets out, obviously, that every death by suicide of a police officer or a staff member is fully investigated as a matter of course by the Crown, and issues around a person's employment or duties obviously may come into that investigation. I think also just worth noting that we expect to be looking at these issues probably into the autumn when we look at the forthcoming police complaints and misconduct bill. So that might be the sort of location, if you like, where we can further probe this issue. But your points are noted and I absolutely agree with them. Thank you. Okay. Fulton, then Colette.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think it's just actually moving on from the point that you've raised there, and I don't disagree with a lot that's been said, but one of the evidence sessions we had, I think it was a round table, it came back quite clearly that, you know, these situations are often very complex, and it might, pressures at work or work-related issues might be having an impact on the person, but it might not. So therefore, I'm actually surprised that, you know, perhaps Police Scotland, and I might be wrong on this, but from what we've got here in front of us, aren't maybe more open to trying to make some sort of analysis of that. I know that we need to be careful about how that takes place, that analysis, but an analysis of where maybe work pressures are more of a leading factor, if there's any, as Jamie was talking about, various different situations that police officers can find themselves in, especially in these times when additional pressures are put on them, to try and find out if there's any, pattern in there about officers that are maybe attending specific types of incidents or have been involved in specific types of investigations against them. Is there some sort of pattern emerging where perhaps it's not, doesn't always lead to the tragic situation we've described today, but maybe as other impacts on mental and emotional health? If there's, I would like to see that. I think actually we're taking a lot on this as a committee, but what more can the committee do? But I think actually Police Scotland have got a bit of work to do here, as we've asked them before. And I know the committee did ask them, and it's under paragraph 10 in our papers about the response to that, which I don't think they say yay or nay to it, but they certainly don't seem to say that they're going to do it. But I think that there would be a bit of work for the police themselves to try and analyse situations. But perhaps they are doing that, and they might write it into the session to say that they're in process of doing that or have done that, and here's what they're finding. But I think that's really the only way we can find out what impact the work pressures are having on people's health, because these situations, as everybody around this table knows, are very complicated. There's likely to be numerous factors involved in a person's well-being. But what role is the job having, and is there a pattern there that's emerging over case after case of people who have experiencing poor mental or emotional health?
Thank you, Fulton. Thanks for that. And I'll bring in Colette, and then we'll maybe just tie things up.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Can I just say as well that I echo what everyone else has said in terms of, I think it's a brilliant piece of work that we've done here, and opening that up and listening to some of these officers who, you know, have gone through such a traumatic time in their lives as well. The one thing that I wanted to pick up on was item 9, which is on page 2 of the response from Police and Mental Health, and that's in relation to the scheduling of the system in the courts and how that's progressing, because it looks to me like Police Scotland, you know, are really having to wait for the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and the Scottish Courts as well in order to try and get some sort of response. Now, I know that work-life balance is absolutely, you know, huge here, and we heard from numerous evidence sessions as well that, you know, the time taken, the impact it has on other officers as well, and being able to get their days off is huge. And I think we need to sort of push, you know, the Crown Office as well as Procurator and courts as well to see how that's progressing, really. And I mean, for me, the thing was, there was a bit of pushback when we attended Glasgow Sheriff Court in terms of remote access when it comes to trials as well. So I'm not sure how that, or, you know, if it's getting pushed back or not, but I'd be keen to find out more about that. And the other thing as well is, we've just been talking about budgets. There's efficiency in a more smarter way of working here, notwithstanding their own mental health, in terms of accessing trials remotely for police officers. Leave it at that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to come in? No? Okay, thanks very much. I agree with all the points that have been made. There is work underway, which is very welcome. I think it's a piece of work that we continue. It's gained some traction, and I'm keen that we can support this work going forward. On the topic, or on the issue of looking a little bit more closely at issues around suicide, I'm quite happy to suggest that we maybe insert something further down the line as part of our ongoing work looking at mental health and policing. As I said earlier on, some of what we've covered, I suspect, will be areas that we will consider in the forthcoming police complaints and misconduct bill. And I did have another point in my head, which I've completely forgotten about. On the issue of the position that the Lord Advocate has, we can circulate the correspondence from her that I think quite helpfully outlines the role of Crown Office and her explanation around fatal accident inquiries and police officers and staff. So I think that's... Are members happy with that proposal?
Yep.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thanks very much for that. Okay, that concludes our business in public this morning. Before we move into private, just a couple of points to make. Next week, I expect the committee to consider several statutory instruments relating to the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Articles Scotland Act of 2022. We will also be looking at a draft report on the Children Care and Justice Scotland Bill. And we will also have an initial discussion about our approach to the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, which has just been introduced. So thank you all, and we'll now move into private. Thank you.